Good afternoon, everyone. And welcome to the celebration of Peter's life. For those of you who have the red booklets, please join us on page 13. Blessed be our God, always, now, and forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. Trinity, most holy, have mercy on us. Cleanse us of our sins, O Lord. Pardon our transgressions, O Master. Look upon our weaknesses and heal them, O Holy One, for the sake of your name. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the servant of God, Peter, and for his blessed repose, let us pray to the Lord. That his transgressions committed deliberately or through human frailty be forgiven, let us pray to the Lord. That he be numbered with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, let us pray to the Lord. That his soul may enter into the land of the living, into a place of light, where all the saints and the just repose, let us pray to the Lord. That he may stand uncondemned before the fearsome judgment seat of Christ, let us pray to the Lord. That he may inherit the eternal kingdom of heaven, let us pray to the Lord. That he may have part in the never-ending joy that is the eternal inheritance of all the holy ones, let us pray to the Lord. For our deliverance from all misfortune, anxiety, and need, let us pray to the Lord. Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and protect us, O God, by your grace. As we remember our all-holy, immaculate, most blessed, and glorious Lady, the Mother of God and ever Virgin Mary, together with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and our whole life to Christ our God. For you are the resurrection, the life, and the repose of your departed servant Peter, O Christ our God, and to you we give glory together with your eternal Father and your all-holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Blessed are they whom you have chosen and taken to yourself, O Lord. Their memory be from generation to generation. With profound wisdom and love for mankind, you arrange all things and bestow beneficial things upon all. O only Creator and Lord, grant rest to the soul of your servant, Peter, for he has placed his hope in you, our God who made and shaped us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. In you we have a rampart and haven, and an intercessor most acceptable to God, whom you bore, O Virgin Mother of God, salvation of the faithful. Blessed are those whose life is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Remember, O Lord, the soul of your departed servant. Blessed are those who respect his decrees and seek him with their whole heart. Remember, O Lord, the soul of your departed servant. The law you have given me is more precious to me than thousands in gold and silver. Remember, O Lord, the soul of your departed servant. Your hands have created me and shaped me. Remember, O Lord, the soul of your departed servant. Had not your law been my delight, I should have perished in my affliction. Never will I forget your precepts, for through them you give me life. I am yours, save me. O Savior, save the soul of your servant. Your word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. Give repose, O Lord, to the soul of your servant. I opened my mouth and drew my breath, for my yearning was for your commandments. Give repose, O Lord, to the soul of your servant. Look upon me and have mercy on me, as you do to those who love your name. Give repose, O Lord, to the soul of your servant. Let my cry come before you, O Lord. Give me understanding in keeping with your word. Give repose, O Lord, to the soul of your servant. Let my soul live, and it shall praise you, and your precepts shall help me. I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek your servant, for I do not forget your commandments. Blessed are you, O Lord, teach me your commandments. The choir of saints has found the fountain of life and the gate of paradise. May I also find the way through repentance. I am a lost sheep. Call me back, O Savior, and save me. Blessed are you, O Lord, teach me your commandments. You called me forth from nothingness and have favored me with your divine image. But having transgressed our commandments, you returned me to earth, from which I was taken. Restore me to your likeness, that my original beauty may be renewed. Blessed are you, O Lord, teach me your commandments. Give repose, O God, to your servant Peter, and give him a place in paradise, where the company of the saints and the just shine like the stars. O Lord, give repose to your departed servant and overlook all his sinfulness. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. Rejoice, O pure one, who gave birth to God in the flesh for the salvation of all. The human race has found salvation through you. May we also, through you, find paradise, O most pure and blessed Mother of God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Glory be to you, O God. Again and again in peace, let us pray to the Lord. We also pray for the repose of the soul of the servant of God, Peter, who has fallen asleep, and for the forgiveness of his offenses, voluntary and involuntary, that the Lord God may place his soul where all the just repose. Lord, have mercy. Let us ask Christ, our immortal King and our God, for the mercy of God, for the kingdom of heaven, and for the forgiveness of all his sins. Grant this, O Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. O God of spirits and of all flesh, you trampled death. You made the devil powerless, and you gave life to your world. Now, O Lord, to the soul of your servant Peter, who has fallen asleep, grant rest in a place of light, a place of verdure, a place of tranquility, from which pain, sorrow, and mourning have fled. As the good and loving God, forgive every sin of thought, word, or deed he has committed. There is no one who will live and will not sin, for you alone are sinless. Your justice is everlasting justice, and your word is truth. For you, O Christ, our God, are the resurrection, the life, and the repose of your servant Peter, who has fallen asleep. And we give glory to you together with your eternal Father and your most holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Have mercy on me, God, in your kindness. In your compassion, blot out my offense. Wash me more and more from my guilt, and cleanse me from my sin. My offenses, truly, I know them. My sin is always before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned. What is evil in your sight I have done, that you may be justified when you give sentence, and be without reproach when you judge. O see, in guilt I was born, a sinner was I conceived. Indeed, you love truth in the heart, then in the secret of my heart, teach me wisdom. O purify me, then I shall be clean. O wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear rejoicing and gladness, that the bones you have crushed may thrill. From my sins turn away your face, and blot out all my guilt. A pure heart create for me, O God, put a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, nor deprive me of your Holy Spirit. Give me again the joy of your help, with a spirit of fervor sustain me, that I may teach transgressors your ways, and sinners may return to you. O rescue me, God, my helper, and my tongue shall ring out your goodness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall declare your praise. For in sacrifice you take no delight, burnt offering from me you would refuse. My sacrifice, a contrite spirit, a humbled, contrite heart, you will not spurn. In your goodness, show favor to Zion. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will be pleased with lawful sacrifice, burnt offerings, wholly consumed. Then you will be offered young bulls on your altar. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For each one of us comes a most important time in life. And that is the hour of passing from this life to the next, from our earthly existence to a spiritual one, from this which is temporary to that which is eternal. And from that moment will be decided our future. In the Holy Scriptures, the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 11, we read, "When the clouds are full, they pour out rain upon the earth. Whether a tree falls to the south or to the north, wherever it falls, there it shall lie. One who pays heed to the wind will not sow, and one who watches the clouds will never reap. Just as you know not how the breath of life fashions the human frame in the mother's womb, so you know not the work of God which he is accomplishing in the universe." These words were written thousands of years ago. You know, yet they are very profound, even today in this modern day and age. We know not how the breath of life fashions the human frame in the mother's womb. We know of the greatness of God's love for us. We, the created, cannot fully comprehend the Creator, but we can understand something of God's love for us. You know, just like a little kid can't fully understand the parents. You know, when a kid asks for a chocolate bar every 5 minutes, well, a good parent will say no. But they don't understand why the parent is saying no. See, they're not at that level. And just like with us, we don't understand everything that happens in life. But we do know that God loves us. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, while preaching and teaching on this earth, once told the parable of the wedding feast. And he said, the kingdom of heaven is similar to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast. From this parable, we are taught that our Lord, who is represented by the king, will call each and every one of us to be with him, to rejoice with him, and to partake in his banquet, which has been prepared for us in the kingdom of heaven. And to that heavenly banquet, today we lead Peter. Reading the parable further, we hear that the invited guests had refused to accept the invitation. So the king sent his servants to go out to the roads and invite to the feast whomever they found, so that the hall was filled to its fullest. In the last verse of the parable, Jesus said, many are invited, but few are chosen. Where do we find ourselves in the parable? Do we accept the invitation? Or do we turn the invitation down? Do we strive to better ourselves spiritually, or do we look the other way and dwell only on that which is earthly? Or maybe we don't care either way. The reign of God isn't something that is out there beyond our grasp and imagination. Our Lord said in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17, the coming of the kingdom of God cannot be observed, and no one will announce, look, here it is, or there it is, for the kingdom of God is already among you. I think that's one of the most important lines in the Bible. The kingdom of God is already among you. It starts here with us. We're part of that kingdom of God already, starting here on earth. And you know, sometimes, because Jesus compared heaven to a banquet, sometimes I think that Jesus really was Ukrainian, because he's always talking about food and compared himself to the bread of life. And, you know, we all love homemade bread, and especially those special breads at Christmas time, the kolach, and Easter, the Pascha, you know. And he compared in the reading heaven to a big banquet. And we all know what that's about, or a wedding feast. We dress in our finest. We are excited. We enter there. We could smell all the pierogies and cabbage rolls cooking, and turkey and the ham and everything like that. And we're happy. That's part of kingdom of God. Rejoicing together. I remember when I was a little kid going to Baba Ngido's. On special occasions, they'd have all the normal Ukrainian food. Normal meaning pierogies, cabbage rolls, nalesnike, the crepes with cheese, everything with cream and dill. But on the special occasions, Baba Ngido would make their specialty items, like head cheese, which I didn't care for too much because they put everything in it, the skin and the, all that stuff. I just passed that by. Pickled pork's feet. No, thank you. Jellied pork tongue wasn't too bad. But most of the time, I just passed by everything and said, yeah, I'll just stick to pierogies and cabbage rolls and some borscht with those little vushke, those mushroom dumplings in them. But that was their celebration, their joy. They didn't waste anything. They put everything in that head cheese. That was part of their joy. So being a big Ukrainian family, we all know what food is about. And the joy and happiness that comes with family gatherings. And we give thanks for that. Even in spite of everything COVID has brought to us or taken away from us, eventually, you know, we'll get back. There's a commercial on TV, one of the channels, I can't remember. It shows a family gathering at Christmas time. They're playing cards, they're snacking, they're having fun, sharing a glass of wine. And then the last caption comes on writing, "Someday it will be like this again." And I thought that was just an awesome commercial. I can't remember what they were advertising, what they were selling or whatever. I don't remember. But I remember that caption, "Someday it will be like this again." And it will, but we have to be patient and trust in God and God's will in leading us. Amen. May our Lord and God, Jesus Christ, who has given his disciples and apostles his divine authority to retain or to forgive the sins of the fallen people, and from whom we have also received the power to do the same, I forgive you, spiritual child Peter, whatever sins you may have committed in life, with malice or in weakness, to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For the repose of the soul of the servant of God, Peter, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever and ever. Amen. I would now like to invite the eulogist forward to share with us something of Peter's life. Thank you.
For whoever's out there. My name is Brent Zelensky. I'm Pete's grandson and oldest child to Gary and Penny. You know, it's something, who would have thought that the funeral for a guy who was born in the age of the horse and carriage and steam engines would be celebrated over the internet today? It's something else. Anyway, it's an honor to have been chosen to provide tribute to our dear Peter Zelensky. It's been a tough couple of weeks, and the postponements and circumstances certainly didn't help matters. But it did give me some time to prepare for today, and I'd just like to say thank you to all of you who shared your stories with me. It was a pleasure connecting with you, and I appreciate your help. So how do you sum up 100 years of life? Well, I think you just take it one story at a time. It gives me a lot of ground to cover. And with us not being able to get together to share our stories amongst each other, I hope it's okay if I go a little longer than usual. So Peter's story starts with the humblest of beginnings. He was born the 10th of 11 kids to Leon and Anastasia Zelensky on May 24th, 1920. Leon and Anastasia had immigrated to Canada, now Ukraine, from Austria, about 10 years earlier, and he was born into the second house that they had built on their homestead in the Kalina district. His childhood would be spent on that farm, growing up with his siblings and helping with the growing family farm. I don't know a lot about his childhood, except that it wasn't an easy life. Each morning he would have to tend to the horses, clean the barns, and walk to school. He attended Kalina School, about a mile and a half down the road, which his parents were instrumental in building. His mother placed a high value on education, making sure her kids would be able to make good lives for themselves in the world. His father viewed work as more important than school, so after the eighth grade, it was officially time for Pete to start working. This was fairly typical of the time. On Sundays, the family attended church at Sandberg. His Ukrainian Catholic faith would remain strong throughout his life. When World War II began in 1939, Peter was about 19 years old. From what I understand, his parents petitioned for him and his younger brother, Walter, to not be drafted because they were needed to help on the farm. With many of the region's men gone to war, I guess you could say Pete and Walter had a chance to enjoy the single life right through their 20s. They enjoyed going to dances at Honeymoon Hall and other area establishments. Grandpa told the story about how it wasn't always easy to get away from the farm and have a private life. His mother in particular was in no rush to see them marry and leave the farm. He said sometimes they'd have to trick their parents to sneak away. Sometimes Walter would play the organ and distract them while Pete would push the car down the driveway. Then they could sneak away later in the evening. Other times they would put their suits on under their coveralls and pretend they were going to cut wood, only to sneak away to a dance, a card game, or other social. If you've ever seen old pictures of the two of them in their 20s, you'll know what good-looking men they were, that they always tried to dress their best. His sense of style and pride in how he carried himself would carry on with Pete right through his life. I always remember him looking so handsome in his suits at church, and that he even wore slacks and tucked-in shirts when he was working on the farm. In fact, it wasn't until his 90s that he would finally adopt a more casual style and start wearing jeans. But country dances and high fashion sense weren't Pete's only ambitions. At some point in his 20s, he decided to leave the farm and make his way out to Vancouver in search of warmer weather and a better life. He said it was too wet out there, so he decided to come home. But having lived out there myself for a couple of years, I have my own theory. BC is a beautiful place, and it would be a wonderful place to live if it wasn't for British Columbians. They have a way of making you yearn for the prairies again. And if his time there was anything like mine, the pull of his prairie roots probably proved too strong to bear. So he made his way back, and he spent the rest of his 20s either helping on the farm with Walter or cutting cord wood from around home to sell at the box factory in PA. In 1950, at 30 years old, Pete finally left the family homestead and settled on his own half section next door. Although he had been given the land by his parents, it was no easy task starting from scratch. He said all he had to start with was an old Ford pickup that was held together with baler twine. But he and Walter set up a small sawmill in that yard, and between cutting lumber, farming his land, and taking some different jobs in the city, he started to make a go of things. He had a small house for himself where he could eat and sleep and take apart engines on his kitchen table. In 1952, at 32 years old, his bachelor days would finally end when he met the woman he had been looking for. He met my dear Grandma Sophie at a cafe in Prince Albert where she was a waitress. Grandpa always told me that he knew she was the right one because she was very pretty and she was stronger than any other woman he had known. She came from a good, hard-working family, and he knew she would be able to handle a tough farm life and be able to support him in his ventures. So on July 27, 1952, they married at St. Helen's Church in Brooksby. His sister Helen Guda once told me how happy Sophie's mother and family were at that wedding. She said they were just genuinely nice, joyful people. Anyway, the following year, 1953, they welcomed their first child, Connie. Gary, Karen, Brian, Cheryl, Harry, and James would follow, completing their family of nine in 1966. With seven kids under the age of 16, life was hectic, to say the least. In the late 1950s, through his forestry work and dealing with the timber board in PA, Pete learned about planing lumber. In 1960, he bought a portable planer mill in Edmonton and brought it back out to the farm. It was another way to supplement his income because farming on its own wasn't enough with all those mouths to feed. The mill would keep him on the road during the week, planing lumber on farms around home and in the various communities, all the way out to White Fox. Auntie Cheryl recounted that when the kids were acting up, Grandma would sometimes threaten, "Just wait until your dad gets home." But by the time he got home, most of the infractions had been long forgotten, and Pete's returns would be welcome more often than not. Cheryl said he never came home empty-handed. He would usually have pockets full of candies or coins for the kids. She also said that if you were lucky enough to get to go to town with him on Saturdays, you'd get a nickel, a dime, or if you were really lucky, a quarter to spend as you pleased. Apparently, the only other ways to get your hands on those coins were to wash his feet, brush his hair, or wait for them to fall out of the pocket. When he wasn't on the road, the planer would be set up at the farm. Farmers would bring their lumber for him to plane, or he would buy wood to plane and sell on his own. His boys helped out as they grew up, and he employed a lot of other local men. In those days, providing meals to your crews was also part of the deal. And I guess that's why Pete needed such a strong, hard-working wife. Grandma not only kept her seven kids fed, but she would provide coffee and snacks twice a day, and also cook lunches and sometimes suppers for Pete's crews, as well as any other men and their families that made their way out to the farm on business. It was a good business that Pete would run great until the late 1970s. Profits were mostly put into buying more land and equipment to grow the farm. By 1976, he started to step away from the planer, and his sons Brian and Perry took over more responsibilities. In 1978, they took over the reins and eventually completely took over by 1985. They would end up making their own careers out of it for another 25 years or so up in the ranch. This let Pete bring his focus back to the farm. Farming was in his blood, and it was always his real passion anyway. But it wasn't easy. The droughts and poor grain prices of the 80s made things tough on the farm, and the boys' other businesses often supplemented things to keep it going. But they persisted, eventually buying some land south of PA and steadily growing the farm as best they could. Finally, in the late 90s and 2000s, things started to pick up again, and the farm would see some of its most aggressive growth. As Pete aged, his involvement never really ceased. He remained the boss right until the end. Grandpa continued to farm well into his 80s, and even when he could no longer run equipment, his keen farming intuition and wisdom kept him involved right until his final years. He took great pride in watching his sons Gary, Brian, and James continue to manage and build the farm into what is now a thriving 9,000-acre venture. Pete's transition from the lumber industry back into the farm in the late 1970s and 80s also marked the addition of his and Sophie's first grandkids. First came Tracy and Glenn from Brian and Janet, then Brianne from Connie and Ron, then me from Gary and Penny. Then it all just went downhill from there. By 1989, Grandpa had a dozen or so grandkids. In fact, he had so many so fast that he resorted to calling us all Gilbert for a while, because he couldn't remember all of our names. Anyway, the grandkids kept coming right through the 90s and early 2000s, eventually totaling 21 in all. He eventually learned all of our names, too. I named them all, but we don't want to be here all day. He was a good grandfather. For me and many of his other grandsons, he became my first boss. I started cutting grass for him at the farm when I was about 10 or 11 years old. He pinned me with a fistful of quarters. He always had these leather pouches full of quarters from the laundry machines at his apartment building. The better job I did, the more quarters I would get, and eventually I had the place looking like a park. To some of us grandkids, he was kind of like another dad. Cousin Chantel told me a story about Grandpa taking care of her once when she was sick. She had thrown up at school, and Grandpa came to Meek Park to pick her up. Before they left for home, he thought, "You better get her something to settle her stomach." So they stopped at the store and bought her a bag of cheesies. Well, guess who was cleaning up cheesy puke when they got home? Probably not Grandpa. Anyways, as the years went on, Pete would watch his kids and grandkids grow up and have their own careers and families and successes. He was always so proud of us. Whenever I would stop into the farm to say hi, he'd always want to know how my life was going and what I was driving. He loved his cars, trucks, motorcycles, campers, and John Deere tractors too. The first car of his that I can remember was this Diamond Jubilee Lincoln. It's a huge car. I think it's one of my earliest memories of my life. I remember sitting in the back seat of this huge car with little oval windows in the back. It probably could have fit all of us grandkids back there. Later, he would drive this red Chevy pickup that Cousin Glenn and I used called the Rad Truck instead of the Red Truck. He must have had 100 vehicles over his lifetime, and they always had to be spotless. His fierce independence would keep him trying to change the oil and do maintenance on these cars well into his 90s. But to him, I don't think it was ever as much about the kind of car or truck as it was about the deal. This guy knew how to get a deal. He would work the local car salesman for sometimes weeks, trying to get them to come down on whatever he was looking at. If he wasn't at a dealership looking for something specific, he was at auctions looking for something to flip. Being towed around to auction sales with Grandpa, my dad, and my uncles was a huge part of my childhood, and I was always most excited whenever they would buy a car. I think it was kind of an ongoing contest between all of them on who could get the best deal on a purchase and who could make the most money off of the sale. When he wasn't wheeling and dealing, he was visiting. He was close with his brother Walter, and many Sundays we'd see them have a few drinks in the afternoon, followed by naps on the couches in the afternoon. He tried to keep in touch with his other siblings, either meeting them in town for coffee or lunch on weekends, or having them stop in at the farm when they could. Whenever anyone made their way out to the farm, he always had time to chat, and I would invite them in for coffee or for Grandma to fix them something to eat. I can just imagine that after 68 years of marriage, the thousands of coffees, puff wheat squares, and pierogi dinners Grandma must have stirred because of Grandpa's unwavering friendliness to family, friends, neighbors, farmhands, and acquaintances alike. That welcoming spirit combined with Sophie's generous hospitality is really what made that farm a home, not just to them, but to everyone in the family. There was no judgment or pretentiousness, just an open home and the ability to shoot the breeze with whoever had the time to chat. The weather, grain prices, current affairs, good deals, and local gossip were always fair game. If you were lucky enough to stop in about 10 or 15 years ago, you might have gotten to meet their pet deer, Archie, too. On a summer day, we'd enjoy a warm beer in the garage, and eventually make our way to the house for a Diet Coke or a coffee and chocolate milk and treats for the kids. Stopping in at that farm to visit, Grandma and Grandpa has been a staple of my life and everyone else in the family. It's how my own kids and the rest of his 23 great-grandkids got to know him. Our visits won't stop, but we're sure going to miss seeing the old man sitting in his chair at the end of that table. The fact that we got to do that right into his final year is no doubt a blessing for us all. To live 100 years with no major health issues but aging itself and the touch of the diabetes is truly an amazing feat as well. We're talking about a guy who I never once saw drink a glass of water. It's all about the Diet Coke for Grandpa. If it wasn't for Grandma, I don't think he would have made it to 40 years old, let alone 100. I don't think he could even cook a hot dog. Grandma kept him fed, made sure he took his meds, and always kept such a great home for him. And I really don't think he would have made it this far without her. He really was healthy right until the end. A couple summers ago, he went out for a drive, because of course he got to keep his license until he was 99. He went out to check the crops and he got stuck down at Dickey's Hills. With no cell phone, nobody with him, and nobody even knowing where he was, he decided he was going to have to walk home. He walked about 4 miles home at 98 years old in the summer heat. He said his feet were sore and the vultures were circling, but overall it was no big deal to him. His physical and mental health and resiliency will remain legendary. We can all only hope to be as fortunate as he was in those departments. Anyway, I could go on all day talking about his long life. And what I've said so far is just a sliver of the story of Pete's long life. Although I couldn't get to all the stories shared with me over the last couple weeks, I'd like to thank everyone who reached out and shared their memories of him with me. But there's also the story of his death. I know, like most of us, he hoped to one day just pass quietly in his sleep. Instead, his health failed over the course of about a month. But in that month, he got to see the true test and devotion of his family. Cheryl dropped everything and moved out to the farm from her home in Red Deer to do everything to keep him from having to go into a senior's home. Grandma, his other kids, their spouses, and some of his grandkids also did whatever they could to help out. On behalf of the rest of the family, I can't thank you all enough. Bless you for your help and for allowing him to die at home with the dignity he deserved. That month, I think, also allowed him to leave this world with no unfinished business. We all had our chances to say our goodbyes, and I think he can truly be at rest, at peace, knowing that he raised good people and that he left his mark. In his final days, as 100 years of memories flashed in front of him, those closest to him got to see a glimpse of the values and connections that must have meant so much to him. I got to have a really good talk with him 12 days before he passed. I asked him to tell me what he was most proud of in his long life, and without hesitation, he told me it was his wife and his family. He was so happy with how Sophie had taken such good care of him all those years, and he called his daughters his angels. Grandma, all your years of dedication to him were a true feat. Thank you so much for taking such good care of him and the rest of us for all these years. We all love you for that. So I think you can see making it to 100 was not his biggest accomplishment. His biggest accomplishment was the life he built for himself and his family over the course of those 100 years. I know he lamented that he was the last of his siblings and friends to go, but if someone had to be last, I'm glad it was him. Grandpa, you were a good man. You'll be missed dearly, but your legacy will live on, and all of us who are so lucky to have had you in our lives. Although we've lost you in this world, I think we've all gained another angel on our sides. So rest easy, Grandpa, and God bless your soul. On behalf of the family, I'd like to say thank you so much for joining us today, as well as all of you who called and reached out with your sympathies. Your support means so much to all of us, and thank you for that.
I once was lost. chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace.
Journey's end, I'll always be my father. Oh, Keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. I don't belong. Oh, you say I'm yours.
sun. The sun is going down. All I see is love around me. You know what I believe. Now I see so completely. I need you to know that time is letting go. Don't cry, dry your eyes. Can't you hear the angels calling me up, up above? Can't you hear the angels calling me home, me home? Take my hand, stay with me as I surrender. We've lived a life of happiness.
get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky. The first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane. Or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down. Gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain, so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, and so much work to do. But when I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace.
Didn't know today would be our last, that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question. Only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Made my troubles feel